Hi everyone, my name is Suri Deitch and I'm Dean of the Tulane School of Professional Advancement. And I'm really excited to welcome you to today's webinar on the future of information technology in our topsy-turvy world of 2020. Tulane School of Professional Advancement, or SOPA as we call it, and our information technology program offer Tulane quality bachelor's degrees and master's degrees in an online format that is accessible to adult students with busy and demanding lives. And we're really excited to have you join us for the webinar today. You'll hear the official introductions in a minute, but I just want to acknowledge our panelists, our faculty members, Bill Riles and Ralph Russo, but especially two great supporters of our program, Terry Takai, with her decades of pathbreaking IT leadership, or I should say IT leadership as a woman in an industry, both in the public and private sectors, and Scott Wolf, who founded and runs Levelset, one of the hottest tech companies in the southeastern US, and who comes from one of New Orleans' most notable families of serial entrepreneurs, including one of my all-time favorite alums, Jane Wolf, who is the SOPA representative on the Alumni Association Board of Directors. I'm really excited to hear what all four of them have to say about the future of IT. And with that, I will introduce my colleague, Bill Riles, Professor of Practice in IT and Associate Director of the program. Thanks again and welcome.
Thank you, Dean Deitch. Welcome to today's event, Digital Realities 2020 and Beyond. As Suri said, I'm Bill Riles, Associate Director and Professor of Practice at Tulane School of Professional Advancement IT Programs. I am excited to serve as the host for today's event. And I just want to say thank you for joining us. I know we're in for an informative session over the next hour. This webinar is designed to be interactive. You can participate in Q&A with us by asking questions at any time during the presentation. Please use the Zoom chat function to submit your questions for our expert panel. We have some time reserved at the end of the webinar for some audience Q&A. We will address as many of these questions as we can during this afternoon session. Joining me today are Scott Wolf, Terry Takai, and Ralph Russo. Scott Wolf is a leading entrepreneur in the New Orleans area. Scott founded Levelset, as Suri mentioned earlier, which is headquartered in New Orleans and is used by thousands of contractors and suppliers nationwide to make payments easier, faster, and less stressful on billions of contracts values each year. Scott has led Levelset through three rounds of venture capital financing, raising over $16 million in outside investments from national venture capital firms. After graduating law school, he practiced construction law as a founding partner of Wolf Law Firm. And since high school, he's owned and also operated a software design company, The Web Lab. Scott also serves as an active member of the Tulane School of Professional Advancement Industry Advisory Board for the IT program. Scott has been recognized by the New Orleans City Business as an Innovator of the Year and part of their Leadership in Law Hall of Fame. Scott has been on the Silicon Bayou 100 list every year since 2014. He is the winner of Idea Village Idea Pitch and also is the ACG's reigning emerging growth company. Thank you, Scott, for joining us.
Terry
Takai is the executive director of the Center for Digital Government, which is a national research and advisory institute on information technology policies and best practices in state and local government. She worked for Ford Motor Company for 30 years in global application development and information technology strategic planning. From Ford, she moved to EDS in support of General Motors. Her longtime interest in public service led her to the government sector as the first Chief Information Officer, CIO, for the state of Michigan, then as the CIO for the state of California and a member of the governor's cabinet. She then moved on to become the CIO for the United States Department of Defense. She was the first woman to be appointed to this high-ranking role. She then served as the CIO for Meridian Health Plan. She is a member of several national industry advisory boards, including the IT Program Advisory Board here at Tulane. Terry has won numerous national awards, including Government Magazine's Public Official of the Year, CIO's Magazine, CIO Hall of Fame, Government Technology Magazine's Top 25 Doers, Dreamers, and Drivers, Information Week's Most Influential Government CIO, and the Women in Defense Excellence in Leadership Award, and the Department of Defense Medal for Distinguished Public Service. And if all of this wasn't enough, she's also served as my professional mentor for many years. Thank you, Terry. Ralph Russo is the professor of practice and the program director for the Tulane University School of Professional Advancement Information Technology Programs, where he is focused on keeping the learning delivery and IT curriculum on pace with cutting-edge technology, security, and industry advancement. He has taught numerous classes in both the Homeland Security and the Information Technology Programs since 2011. Before joining academia full-time, Ralph has been a nationally recognized subject matter expert on technology in the homeland security and public safety domains. He has served in leadership positions for the technology companies for over 15 years that specialize in public safety. He has consulted for multiple federal, state, and local organizations to successfully guide the development, deployment, and adoption of IT systems for security and public safety. Ralph is a retired and decorated New York City police officer. His 20 plus year career with NYPD included leadership positions and a wide array of investigative and field assignments. He served as the commanding officer for the Organized Crime Task Force and the NYPD Intelligence RIC Watch. As an entrepreneur, he has owned two startup technology firms that focused on delivering security solutions to businesses handling personal data and creating, marketing, and delivering software for police officers. Ralph used his vast experiences in technology and public safety to create and deliver the first graduate and undergraduate cybersecurity courses at Tulane in 2011. He was also awarded the John Percy Dyer Award for Teaching Excellence in 2012. Thank you, Ralph.
Thank you, Bill.
Before we get started with our expert panel, I would like to briefly set the landscape on our webinar topic today. I think we all can agree that 2020 started out in the way we all might expect. We had priorities, we had projects on our list, then along came the pandemic. And our response to the pandemic has taken over. The digital transformation has been happening all around us for years, but the COVID-19 pandemic simply hit the fast forward button on the worldwide adoption of digital technologies, creating this digital reality of 2020, which is our theme for today's webinar. The COVID pandemic forced organizations, corporate, government, and academic to react quickly and implement changes at a rate never before seen, all the while forcing employees out of the office to work remotely. Corporate facilities, government buildings, and academic classrooms were shut down, which immediately restricted access to critical services. Because of technology or the technologies running our response to the pandemic has been varied, we've seen some successes and unfortunately some failures as well. One thing is for certain is that we all have learned a great deal since our response began around the first quarter of this year. Many organizations have been working on improving technology and the digital services for the past several years, but many were not where they needed to be when the pandemic hit. The organizations that were already on the cloud or software as a service journey were better situated than others. We know that certain practices caused by the pandemic, like social distancing, remote work, and online-based interaction are likely here for a while as we move beyond our post-pandemic planning. A plethora of new and emerging technologies have been thrust into mainstream adoption for corporate, government, and academic organizations. And this trend is not likely to slow down. 2020 has been all about survival. But as we look forward to 2021 and beyond, what is the new reality as we maximize this shift to digital? We are in unprecedented times and in uncharted territory. And when in uncharted territory, someone has to make a map of the best practices, and to navigate these unknown waters of the future. And one of the best ways to do that is turn to people who have been there, done that, wear the t-shirt, and have experienced success in this new digital reality. That's exactly what our panel of experts have done in 2020. We're going to discuss many of these themes in today's session. With that, let me turn it over to our expert panel. I'm going to start off with Scott. So Scott, let me start off our discussion with you today. You know, due to your experience in reaching the industry, I know that you work with many businesses and have similar conversations that I've talked about the radical rate of change experienced in 2020 and what the future holds. We know that many businesses have pivoted to employee remote work options, but some of the core business operations, they've evolved as well due to this pandemic. Can you give us your perspective of what you've seen this year and what the future will behold for private businesses?
Yeah, thanks, Bill. Thanks for having me today. I'm excited to be part of this discussion. It's definitely been an odd year, an interesting year. My perspective is kind of coming from a little kaleidoscope of things that I see, at least from where I sit. On the one hand, I have our own business. It's a technology company. We were one of those people that Bill mentioned in the introduction is kind of like ready to be cloud-based. We were very cloud-based. 200 employees, we were across multiple offices. We weren't remote, but we worked remotely at times. We have thousands of users who are contractors and material distributors that are small and big, and they have, they were not necessarily all prepared to go remote. A lot of these are office environments, like material distributing companies who have offices that staff those things. Another interesting place that I saw a lot over the past few months, just to set up like my perspective, is actually through our investors and through our board and through working with all these companies in their portfolios, because there was a lot of comparing notes going on over this period. And you know, the obvious thing, the thing that just hits everybody in the face with respect to 2020 and the pandemic and all the change we're seeing so fast is the virtualness and the remoteness of the workplace. And actually, I had it, and I'll touch on this in a second. I thought about it this way as Bill set it up, which is a lot of this stuff was happening, and this is the fast forward button. When we look back in early mid-March, it was so fast. I had a planning meeting with my team in New Orleans. We flew people in, and during the planning meeting, we said, should we be talking about this pandemic? And we were like, nah. And then the next day, we're talking about setting this thing up to shut down. So when we go remote, we think, okay, we're gonna be going remote for 2 or 3 weeks. And here we are, we're still remote for the most part. And you know, you see these major companies like Google and Facebook and Dropbox, Amazon, Microsoft, that are saying that they're going to be remote forever. Like, that's what they're saying. And what's going on here, right? There's an interesting thing about this where if you look at these companies, they push the workspace to this open office type of work environment over the past two decades. And I think there's something to notice here about what they're going to do to the workplace in the next two decades. And they're sitting here saying, we're remote first. I think it's really interesting. I'll tell you a little bit about my experience of how I think that this pandemic is dictating how our workplace will be. And it's something that we have to all pay attention to. So as we've been remote in the past 6 months, we've onboarded like 30 people that we've never met. We're just a small company, right? So we've onboarded 30 people we haven't met. We have a lot of young employees, unfortunately for New Orleans, that are moving back home. We have polled our office, and a vast majority of the people who work for us don't want to come back in a full-time environment, at least for the foreseeable future. I think about this thought experiment that you may have heard of, the ship of Theseus. I've talked about this with my executive team and with my board at times, which is this concept that if a ship leaves the harbor and it's got all this wood on the ship, and then it replaces the wood plank by plank on the journey, when it gets to its destination, if it's a completely different ship, when did the ship actually change? When did the boat actually change? And the thing is that with this, you know, we've started talking about in the past, when are we going to return to the office? But at some point here, we're not going to return to the office. We're going to be we're something different. At some point, we're different. And if we want to go back to an office environment, we're actually going to have to change from what we are. We are remote. And increasingly, we are remote. And I think that's what these bigger companies are noticing, is that they are remote and they can't just sit here and wait to go back to the office. And over the next 1.5 years or 2 years, for the next 10 months or 6 months, however long this thing is, in order for us to go back, we're actually gonna have to change. And I don't think we're gonna change, because this is not new. Exactly what Bill said, it's a fast forward. Remote work was here, it was gaining, it's now accelerated. And it's almost like, who's gonna go back and why? It's gonna go back to something different, some hybrid, some something else. It's like retail, right? It was dying, and this is gonna accelerate it. Now, when you think about technology, and I think about technology and how technology leads the way on this point, you have the obvious things like Zoom and Slack and all these work environment things. And they were, you know, a lot of these things were caught on their feet, like even Zoom. One of the guy, somebody who sits on the Zoom board is on our board. We share investors, and they've been like blown away by the adoption. So much so that they had, I don't know if you saw this story in the beginning, but the parliament in Britain was meeting over Zoom, and it was all kinds of security problems because Zoom didn't plan to be a parliament tool, you know? And like, here they are. So you have more humans, more tools, all this stuff where people are connected. And I have a comment about that that's interesting, I think, in a way, in a second. There's some less obvious stuff with respect to technology, which is around automation. There's so much technology out there. You've seen these stories over time of like how automation and AI is going to take jobs and it's going to change the workforce. We are one of those companies at Levelset. We are a tool that could change the workforce and automate certain tasks. In April, we saw a lot of users coming to us needing to adopt our tool because they couldn't do it in a remote environment. And so they needed to adopt the tool, or they needed to cut costs, and it looked like a place to cut costs. I saw an article on CNN today or yesterday, how one of these articles, you see these headlines all the time, that the pandemic is speeding up automation and 85 million jobs or a lot of jobs are at stake. Our product does this, just like you're seeing remote work come in, just like you see in retail come in, and this is real. And Sears and JCPenney and these things are like warehouses for Amazon now. There is a segment of technology that is coming to take over a lot of the different things that we do. The second thing is interesting about all these workplace tools that touches, you know, you can look at it from a security standpoint because now one of the biggest security risks is people. And people are now spread across all these different tools. They're being onboarded without you ever meeting them. They have all these computers that you can't get your fingers on. Everything's in the cloud. It's a really complicated problem. There's another complicated problem that's interesting that I've seen, which I will call more of like a human problem. I put this into a second category. You have this remote work thing, but then you have this human thing where, you know, when over the past few years, and this year in particular, companies have found themselves having to get involved in sticky things, which is kind of new. And technology is a little bit involved with this. I know, like in our Slack, for example, I see our groups doing things like creating channels around protesting. Creating, you know, like they're communicating kind of like a social network within the company. And so you have all this communication tools that changes the role of the company in certain things that historically I think wasn't necessarily a problem there. We use engagement tools and monitoring tools like Lattice and Office Vibe and things like that to manage the engagement and the welfare of our employees. Mental health and welfare of employees has been something that's definitely gotten more notice and more relevance with everybody being separate and people going through a lot of different things. And there's some tools out there to help monitor that. But then you also have a lot of you have a lot of passion right now, and that passion is coming through in all these tools that we use, and we're trying to manage that. You're also seeing things like again, that's accelerating it, which is workplace reputations and salary information. All this stuff is all becoming more and more technology driven, as opposed to a workplace reputation being managed by New Orleans City Business, right? Well, now it's managed by these technologies that are increasingly like little social networks for people who are in the talent marketplace, that are comparing notes on salaries and jobs. And this creates really good accountability for employers. But all this technology is, I look at it and it's this weird crisis, I think, that could emerge for private companies that you're seeing in the social media space today, that I see as is starting to find some beachhead within private companies and companies having to use technology to try to having to manage all these tools that are being brought into the workplace. And then which tools can they use to manage this stuff, and what is their role in this stuff? I think it's got a lot of there's a lot of complexity, and this year especially has brought that to the forefront. So I'll pause right there, having brought up a few subjects there.
Thank you, Scott. I love that See a Thesis example. I use it in my classes all the time. And when I was thinking about that, you were talking about the automation potentially replacing jobs, but actually it's changing the jobs. The we talk about the normal, and as the world we go into now is actually the new normal. So the See a Thesis kind of works for that. Thank you for that great analogy. As you were talking, I was thinking about several good questions, and I'm sure our audience members have some questions as well. I'll remind everyone to post your questions through the chat. All right, thank you, Scott. Next, I would like to turn it over to Terry. Scott, he laid out some exciting things. We know that we're heading into some really exciting times in the future, and technology is leading the way. So Terry, I want to learn about the government, perspective on this new reality. This past year, agencies implemented technology rates, at unprecedented times and rates faster than they've ever done before, in an effort to keep delivering critical citizen services in the midst of all this pandemic. Government offices were shut down, which immediately restricted access to critical citizen services, forcing government agencies to adopt new citizen interaction channels beyond the traditional coming to the office and face-to-face. So are these changes here to stay in government? And what does the future look like for government agencies, Terry?
Well, thanks, Bill. I really appreciate it. You've hit on two things that I just want to make sure that we're sort of thinking of what the government CIO is facing in kind of two buckets. One is this question of remote work and the fact that government was very slow to adopt remote work. It was treated more as an exception or a privilege than it was a natural way, of actually working. And in a recent poll that we did, we find that over 86% of government leaders are now saying that remote work is going to play a critical role going forward. Now, in that move, a couple of things happened. First of all, CIOs had to scramble just to be able to facilitate that move. But the good thing about it is in government, the CIO, as you know, Bill, isn't necessarily always a respected role and very often got relegated into the back room as an operational position. And that has changed. We're seeing CIOs really dealing with agency heads, with governors, with mayors, county executives. It's really changed the impression of what technology can do just by virtue of the fact of facilitating people to be able to work remotely. So I want to come back to that because I think that that's a major change going forward and will continue to continue, first of all, to be there, as Scott said, in a hybrid version. You know, we are hearing some folks begin to look at, you know, maybe we are going to have different buildings. I was talking to an individual in transportation in Arizona who said that they want to take some of the transportation buildings and make them collaboration centers, for instance. So lots of different concepts on remote work. The second piece of what you talked about is really this dramatic drive to changing citizen services. I think each jurisdiction had some things that they were doing online, but certainly not the drive to actually have that be the major focus in terms of, you know, the way the government services were delivered. So let me just tell you some of the things that governments were investing in. I mean, first of all, they were buying laptops, they were expanding VPN capability, they were doing everything they could to enable remote work. Secondly, that changed the perception around cybersecurity because your endpoints were now very different from the way that they were treating cybersecurity when they were doing it on their own networks. Online and digital services in terms of payments and permits and forms, some of those were online, as you know, but it was spotty, and that changed, particularly in the unemployment insurance and health and human services areas that really had this gigantic intake of people needing services. But it also brought to the fore things like digital signatures and approvals, which were spotty in the past. And part of that was that, to the point of that Scott made about Parliament, many boards and commissions that normally would not have ever done a virtual meeting were now not only holding virtual meetings, but they had to figure out how they were going to meet statutory requirements around documents and signatures. It upped the game on collaboration tools. I think that lots of folks were putting in Microsoft, but not necessarily an adoption of Teams, for instance, in the way that it's happened. And then we're seeing, again, a dramatic change in the citizen streaming tools. So, you know, again, it upped the game both in terms of internal and external. But I think the challenge is that there's still a lot of legacy out there. So while, in fact, to your point, Bill, there were some that had moved to the cloud, it was still for many locations a, well, we're going to get there. You know, there was resistance internally in some cases. And now we're finding that, you know, the point around modernization and being able to actually modernize legacy systems to be able to address both remote work and citizen services has really come to the fore. And in fact, in one county government, you know, the county government is all of a sudden concerned that the CIO hasn't been pushing modernization, when in fact we know the CIOs push it, but it really requires money in order to be able to do it. Now, some of the things that are facing government as they're now, they've moved to remote work, they've really dramatically tried to change citizen services very quickly, but that is going to bring some challenges. I mean, they've run a lot of pilots. You know, the procurement processes were shortened. And so that things that government, as I've heard a CIO say, used to analyze before they put it in, they had to put it in. You've not seen this kind of an adoption of chatbots and AI introduced, particularly into call centers, would never have happened at this pace had things been going the way that they were normally. But now government has to think about how do these integrate into the fabric of what they have from an IT perspective. They've got to look at their workforce, right? I mean, is their workforce ready to continue to do remote work? Do they have the skills, you know, to really adopt cloud as quickly as it's starting to move to adopt some of these new technologies? And I think that there's really now also a look at how can we think about not just doing modernization, not just adopting AI tools, but should we do them to the processes that are out in government today? As you know, Bill, these processes build up over time. It's not clear that all of the processes are value added. And so, you know, how can we actually look at that? And so some of those challenges are now being faced with a budget challenge in every single state. We're hearing everything from 5 to 10% reductions. So where does the technology spend in that? And then also certainly, how do they use CARES funds before the end of the year to actually help them? So what are the things that we believe are going to change? Well, clearly, as we've all said, remote work. Second is going to be the expanded use and continued use of collaboration platforms in any and all forms. Again, the increased attention on that citizen experience in digital. The one that is really getting a lot of attention is digital equity. And how are governments now going to step up in terms of getting engaged again in the broadband question, which of course, you know, happened in around the 2004-2005 timeframe, but every state is now looking at legislation around how do they try to get not just coverage, but how are they able to get affordability and how are they able to get access? And the last point is the priority investment in really moving into modernizing what they have. And all of that is going to mean that there's going to be changes in terms of how IT organizations are structured, and there's going to be a real change in the way that they look at new technologies. So again, it's really going to be around that communication. There's going to be employee changes, you know, a real exploration of new ideas, changes in the way that we look at cybersecurity, and then also changes in the way that we are looking at emerging technologies and the speed with which we're adopting new technologies going forward to meet these demands.
Thank you, Terry. I can absolutely echo your thoughts on the government or the state and local CIO not having a seat at the table. And my my past experience has said that, but also my conversations with CIO colleagues all around the country is showing exactly what you said, that we're rising to the table. We're talking to the cabinet level officials and we're talking to the decision makers. So the IT CIOs and decision makers are playing a role in all governments as we move forward. It's an exciting time. Thank you so much, Terry. All right, Ralph, I would like to turn it over to you. You know, Terry highlighted some really awesome things. You know, and I know that many government agencies are still in the process or in the middle of our transformation efforts, and they wouldn't be able to navigate these waters without the help of leaders like Terry. But so, Ralph, I want to turn to you for the academic side. You know, we talked about the corporate, Scott highlighted that, and Terry highlighted the government side. So what about the academic perspective? So we know that there's the obvious academia response of the research efforts that develops these emerging technologies that were going to be implemented across the board. But Terry brought up a really good point about the workforce of the future, that we have to have workforce in these government agencies and workforce for the private corporations as well. So I want to take our conversation in that direction. So what is the academics response to this pandemic and this digital reality of 2020 as we move forward, you know, beyond the research efforts? What about the human resources and the workforce of the future? You know, businesses and governments alike will need qualified, skilled, and trained employees that are not only employees, but leaders that embrace and understand these new technologies of the future. So what can academia do? What's the academia's response, Ralph?
Well, thank you, Bill. Yeah, it's an important question. And if as Scott says, if industry is something different coming out of this, and as Terry said, if CIO's roles have changed and citizen services are changing radically, are we doing justice to students to prepare them in the traditional sense? I think education and academia absolutely has an important role in ensuring workers are ready for the future. So because we don't adapt, we'll basically preparing students for a pre-pandemic world reality, well, they need to be prepared for a post-pandemic world. So the future workforce, what we heard tonight, is going to require workers that are lifelong students and learners. As as change accelerates at an accelerated rate, we need workers that are able to change quickly and move to new technologies while not losing sight of their mission. So we need workers that can thrive in a changing environment and contribute and actually contribute to the change, synthesize new ideas, adopt and enhance them. For example, you've got things like that have been coming for a while, like agile and DevOps, and as opposed to traditional development of software and development of systems, working at a distance and working into teams under these concepts is different, and we must prepare students for that. So we need students that are comfortable with multiple modes of communication and are able to bring order and meaning in a fast-paced environment. So that speaks to some of the things that Scott had mentioned. In addition, universities need to get more applied. While it's important to stay true to the academic mission of the university, having an academic or theoretical understanding helps people ride out changes and to understand them and adapt them better. But we also need students that are more applied, whose skills and who are able to apply that theory in a workplace, provide the conceptual and theoretical underpinnings through meaningful workplace application. So we must evolve. And so students need to be exposed to these new realities while at university or while continuing their education at university. For example, our own program has over 250 virtual labs for applied study, hands-on real-world type assignments, but they are graded on how well they can apply those labs to the academic theory, where thereby melding those academic and applied. So not only does the content though need to be more aligned to what industry needs and more applied, but also the delivery, the environment, and the expectations need to change. Classes must be remodeled to mimic non-academic workplace of the future environment, such as and stuff we're doing and have been doing, but now must do at an accelerated rate. Team projects, distance projects, cross-domain projects and programs. For example, in our capstone project brings people from different disciplines together in the same class to show that they not only have mastered their area of study like cybersecurity, but they could also work with people who are network and system admins or cloud experts. So these are things that we're doing to make our programs more applied while not losing sight of academic mission. We've moved more courses online and obviously in regards to this challenge, but we've also gone away from traditional exams to concentrate on group projects. We've actually invented a company that has a org chart and locations and products and a website and an actual infrastructure, a virtual infrastructure for students to study against. This way, when they solve problems, they're not solving academic greenfield problems, they're solving real world context constrained problems. Also the quality and structure of courses is something else that we need to speak about. Going back some years, and online classes in an online school were thought to be less quality. That's not going to work for universities such as Tulane. What we build now are courses that are built to be offered in a variety of methods. It's a solidly built course with academic and applied learning that can be offered online or on ground or in some type of hybrid fashion, but the quality of the course does not change. So these are things that ways that we've been changing. For example, all of our students have their own virtual desktop that belongs to them for their duration of time in our program. When we went and our learning management systems integrated, so when we went fully online to the pandemic, we were able to flip a switch and have those students work effectively from anywhere. All their software is in place. So these are important considerations and things we're doing now. And I think most universities will be doing more of that. And the best way to be applied is to, we heard already, Suri mentioned that Terry and Scott are both members of our industry board, of our industry advisory board. And I think that's a critical factor too. Universities need to be tied to business so that the students we're producing, whether they're lifelong learners, adult learners, career changers, or traditional students, so that the people that we're producing are able to use the knowledge they've gained immediately and directly in industry. You know, the Medical College of Louisiana in 1834 was formed for community physicians to educate doctors in the community. It was very much community mixed, community involved. That, of course, has evolved to become Tulane University, with Tulane School of Professional Advancement continuing that mission. So after several iterations, that's become Tulane. So judging by the amount of increased connection we need going forward, as I see it here at Tulane, perhaps we're heading back to the original model of being totally connected to the community.
Thank you, Ralph. This has been an outstanding conversation. It's really fascinating to see how the government and how the corporate needs are being reflected in what the academic universities is producing in the way of graduates. I want to remind everyone in their audience to submit your questions through the chat function at the bottom of Zoom. You know, this has been an outstanding conversation, but we have some time allotted at the end of this webinar to have some audience Q&A. So I want to invite all three panelists to come back on screen, and we've got a few questions from the audience. And I also, I've got some questions myself. So if you will allow me, I would like to work some of my questions in to you guys and let you answer some of the audience questions as well. The first one that I want to ask, this goes out to all panelists or anyone who wants to answer, is the buzzword that everybody's saying now is cybersecurity. You know, Terry mentioned it directly. You know, cybersecurity is going to change. Scott talked about this new automation, this new technologies is about cybersecurity. So with this new world that we're living in, what keeps you up at night from a cybersecurity perspective? What things are out there that are really concerning to you that we need to think about going forward beyond 2021?
Well, let me just start, I guess, Bill. And you know, interestingly enough, we have a comment in the I think in the chat that also is applicable. I think the couple of things are happening. One is that the adversary, and this is sort of my DoD speak coming through here, and Ralph will recognize this. The adversary isn't changing, if you will. They're getting certainly more active, and it's now all about financial gain. So I think that, you know, number one, we have to be concerned about all the basics and make sure we don't lose those. Second, the technology is not going to completely solve this problem. You know, we're going to have to be vigilant with it. And that, again, this has changed the dynamic because the number of devices and types of devices has changed. The second piece, I think, which is an important one, you know, that Suri's brought up, is that we also have to be concerned about privacy. I mean, while in fact we don't necessarily a straight line link privacy to cybersecurity, there is that demand and dimension, which is, you know, of major importance right now. And it's actually getting even more so in that from a government perspective, we're thinking about, when should the citizen own their data? When should the citizen be able to tell us when, in fact, we can utilize their data, you know, in ways that, you know, perhaps in the past they might not have known about? So there's a security component to it. I think there's a privacy component to it. And I think the final thing is that this is not a problem that's going to be solved. It is an ongoing part of the technology, the infrastructure, and what we run. And I think we all got to get out of that mindset, you know, that there's some magic bullet that's going to solve this and make it go away, because that's not going to happen.
I was going to sleep at night until Terry was telling me about all the problems He's like, oh no, it was a disaster.
Yeah, to jump in on that a little bit, there's no big red easy button on this, isn't it? Today's an article in the New York Times by their tech reporter on, you know, the balance between safety and private and civil liberty, right? And she came up with the same basic thing, which is we don't know, no magic bullet. And unprecedented times and significant change mean that we have to have real discussion here. There's you're not going to just go to one extreme and come up with the answer, because you'll come up with the wrong answer. So real discussion here matters. So number one, it's an excellent article if you get to read Shira Ovid's column today, but know that there are real challenges, both to keep your information private and your civil liberties, and on the other side, to ensure that you stay safe and secure from people who would take or destroy what you have. So this is where we get to work these things out. Exciting times are also dangerous times, right?
what a quaint problem we used to have when you just had to keep a facility secure, and everybody knows that networks and technology, the security comes down to the weakest link. And here we are just spreading the weak link across like billions of people. And that's not something that is, that's a complex problem.
The concept of age old physical security of castle and moat, it really is not applicable in today's world. So that's one of the things we're wrestling with in the cybersecurity world. So we have a question from the audience, and Scott, I'm gonna direct it to you first, and anyone else can follow along. When you were talking about all the remote work that's going on, and it could be every businesses, you know, large businesses are going to go towards fully remote, and you see that being in the wave of the future. So the question is concerned about the human aspect, the interactions. You know, we're losing some of that. So aside from the reality of the pandemic accelerating tech, we know that, but is being considered by corporation that it can be more, you know, decisive instead of connected. Human beings sitting in front of a screen all day and not really talking to each other. So what about the aspects of human interaction? Are we losing some of that? How does that fit into this new landscape?
I kind of touched on, I hinted at it a little bit in my comments opening, because it's a real thing that I don't quite know where to put my finger on it. So there's one thing around mental health, which is a part of this. And that is a fear that I think we should have. And I think I've seen that fear in our company. Like I've seen that that be something that is real, that taking people remote, putting them remote, especially with the turbulence, you know, you have two things going on. You have a lot of turbulence and you have them in a remote environment. A little example I'll give, or how I joke about this, is I say the salespeople, they knew that they were extroverts and they wanted to be around people, and they were right. The engineers, they thought they were introverts and wanted to stay in a closet, and they were wrong. They don't want to stay in a closet. They do want to be around people in some way, shape, or form. And that's been a funny kind of like thing. Like the most introverted people, the closet workers, they crave being around people, and that has a real impact. And I think that's a real, that's a complex impact that we're going to suffer for decades. Probably you see that with like Hurricane Katrina has, us in New Orleans, we know this, there's a lot of studies about the ripple effect of just that one event, from a mental health standpoint in our community. So this is something that is, something that to be looked at. Another thing is what I'm worried about, but I have not seen personally in our company, which I call the cesspool effect. You see in this with like the social media landscape and how decisive and bitter it can get. And here with companies, you have all those same things within the environment of these community of companies, and people are these networks, and these communication tools are very similar to social media. And you see those, I have a little bit of fear about how that plays out within companies who are, kind of in between a rock and a hard place with respect to these things that kind of pop up in those communities, in your community. I haven't seen that. We're small. We have a small community. versus a larger community. But that, you know, this is a strange cocktail that, just like we're, you know, there's the Social Dilemma documentary that's getting a lot of attention right now. Just like we're racing into this environment where social media is doing things that we didn't expect. I think that there's a lot of things that we're not expecting in the corporate environment and all communities as communities change how they are connected and how they communicate. I think corporations are worried. I think the question was, it's an afterthought, or is the well-being of humans an afterthought? I don't think that's the case at all. At least not for some companies. I think people are taking. I'll stop. But you could take a few approaches. You can, like, if there's actually an approach where people want to suffocate and put surveillance on their employees and be like overbearing and monitor all the activities, and, you know, that's one approach. Then you know, I'm now moving into the rambling phrase, because it's very, very complicated. And I don't know if it's an afterthought, but I don't know if it's necessarily something that has any clear answers, or even an ability to clearly see what is the problem to be working on.
Thank you, Scott, for that your perspective and the detailed answer to, as you stated, a very complex question, one we're probably going to ponder for years to come. So let me shift gears a little bit and ask Terry a question. So, you know, it was fascinating to see you describe all the responses in the technical advances that governments did in response to the pandemic. Through your work for the Center for Digital Government, you work with many governments all across the nation. Since the pandemic started, are there any projects that gave you a wow factor? What surprised Terry? What gave her, wow, that was awesome? Is there anything that stands out that you decided was really, really above the best?
Well, there were. And I think some of them are probably maybe not projects per se. But I thought it was absolutely amazing the way that government stood up to be able to support people working remotely. So for instance, there was one organization, one state, that actually had a drive-up capability. So employees could drive up, open up their trunk, they would load whatever computer equipment that they needed and instructions and send them on their way, right? So it wasn't a sophisticated technology solution, but it was a way to address needing to get people up and running very quickly, but doing it in a safe way. The second thing is the explosion of chatbots to be able to handle all of the calls that were coming in, to be able to handle the sort of simpler questions. Because I think, you know, Bill, across the country, the UI systems were breaking and the call centers were just overwhelmed. And I think that, you know, that was another area that we were just really impressed with, the number of states that just said, you know, we might have studied this to death, but now, you know, we're just going to go ahead and do it, right? And I think that it's got people thinking about, you know, again, what does this process automation look like? So that's a couple of areas, just, you know, one that was a low tech, just a service delivery kind of an approach. And the other, which was really moving into new technologies, that just was very, very impressive.
Outstanding. You talked about some automation, and Scott brought it up as well too, that, you know, jobs are changing. There's a lot of automation out there with the chatbots. Things that were typically handled in office are now handled automatically through AI. You know, and Ralph, I know in your program, we have classes on automation, you know, so the world is changing with that. So we have a question from the audience about, as a Tulane alumna and a recent graduate looking for work in the middle of this pandemic, we know the world's changing. Do you guys have any suggestions on how to make yourselves more marketable and where graduates should be looking in this new world and what type of skills? So if you could answer that, but also touch on the automation aspect of, you know, jobs that are traditional may not be in the future, but they're just different. It's the new normal. It's the ship changing the wood.
Bill, I, you know, in responding to that, I would say that that student's already taking a very good first step. Listening to experts like Scott and Terry talk about what the future looks like, well, the next step is, of course, to prepare yourself for that future. You know, make sure that your communication skills, using technology, not just Zoom, but different methods. You heard Scott mention at least 5 or 6 different applications or services that his company uses. And so the idea is to prepare yourself for where you think the world is going, and listening to experts like this and doing more of that is going to help you position yourself to be a more attractive candidate.
A lot of the same rules apply as before with respect to job seeking, especially for early in their career. I do this thing in my onboarding with new employees. We watch this Harvard Business School commencement speech by Sheryl Sandberg, or a piece of it, and she talks a little bit about like that how do you find the job, and I'd recommend taking a look at that. You know, some things she talks about: build your skills, not your resume, which is a lot of what Ralph just mentioned, which is, you know, build your skills, focus on skill building. She has this interesting thing about think about the job, not the job seeker, not you. She gives an example of somebody who went in looking to solve a problem for the business as opposed to thinking about the job. She talks about get a lawn job, take a quota, take a sales role, like do work, do that kind of work. It'll give you so much perspective about just simple things that after you in the workplace for 10 years is very natural, but in the early stages, you don't really know. Those are all kind of things once you get a job. A lot of businesses are started in times like this. Think about entrepreneurship as well.
Thank you, Scott. And this is a great segue to probably our final question tonight. I'm going to pose it to you, Ralph. And Scott was talking about, you know, watching the commencement speech, and that reminds me of a video, a YouTube video that I saw one time before of the MIT graduates. You know, they were electrical engineering graduates, and the reporter held them two batteries in a flashlight, said, can you make it work? You know, and these are MIT graduates in electrical engineering. They could not figure out how to make it work. They could write a thesis and a whole dissertation about it, but they can't actually put it together and make it work. Your topic earlier, you were talking about the appliedness being applied in some of the classes and combining that with the theory. And it goes with our last question of how do you find a job with those, you know, you have those applied skills. But not every job is about technology. You know, we've been talking about technology tonight. There's plenty of jobs that have a technical spin on it, but it may not be, not everybody suited or wants to be an IT person. And not every program in a university is technology. So how does this, your theories on being more applied impact other areas of the university and other job functions as well?
Yeah, so two-part answer on that. I think it applies for every type of field of study. If you're doing research on a particular thing, you could do research under conditions that are more in line with what you would do in private industry. If you had gotten a job, you could create conditions that mimic industry, as opposed to, again, this kind of pristine academic experience. You surely don't want to lose the research and the academic experience, but you want to do it under conditions and in a context that makes it more in tune with what's going on with the world, especially if people are going to continue to learn throughout their whole career. So that's applicable across the board, I think. Bill, you're on. There you go.
Thank you, Ralph. You know, I want to be respectful of our 1 hour time commitment. So unfortunately, we got to wrap it up here. So in closing, I would like to thank everyone for joining us for this outstanding event. And a big thank you needs to go out to our panel of expert speakers, Scott, Terry, and Ralph. And thanks to our audience for spending time with us. Have a great rest of your evening, and thank you for joining us.
Mm-hmm.